Hello friends, my talk today is going to take you to times before history. To tell you a fact, food for mankind has been always a very big issue. And if you talk about prehistoric times, then man depended only on fruits and vegetables. Man could eat grains was only because of one very big discovery and sort of an invention, which is considered the biggest one, and that is fire. It was because fire can be used to cook food that we could start eating grains. And that expanded our possibility of food so drastically that population of mankind has been growing unlike any other animal in the world. In the beginning, the fire was always started with firewood collected from the forest. And when this wood is used for burning, it is very difficult to start as well as it is very difficult to stop, let alone control in between for the cooking purposes. And if you are thinking that energy for cooking is a very small fraction, let me tell you, even today, a very significant fraction of the energy consumed by mankind is for the purpose of cooking. And this firewood-based cooking continued for a long time till 100 or 200 years ago, man discovered a liquid fuel which was much more convenient, and that is in the form of the fossil fuel, petroleum, and kerosene is the form in which a lot of people even today use it for cooking. In rural India, that is one of the major cooking fuels. And to store it, it is much simpler. You store it in a can and you can use it in the household. You can put out the fire very easily and you can control. However, that control is something which is tricky because at times it can go out of control. Explosive fires caused by kerosene tanks stored catching some ignition are fairly common. And when that happens, we wish we didn't have such a fuel stored inside our house. If you look at another issue with this liquid fuel, it is exactly the opposite. And that is unburnt fuel. Why would unburnt fuel be a problem? That unburnt fuel comes out from the flames and lands up onto the roofs of the kitchen as a soot, or worse still, they are found in the lungs of the housewife who's cooking. And this is a property of kerosene, that it will normally give this kind of soot. And that is an incomplete combustion problem. So we have two things on hand. On one hand, kerosene burns explosively, and on the other hand, it doesn't burn fully. When we looked at this as a problem, we said that there is something we can definitely do. Because if burning does not happen completely, that is when you get soot. So that means there is a way of being able to control this fire and control the soot, both. Look at this can which is storing kerosene. It is usually, let's say, not full. So let's say half full, and half is liquid and upper half is air. But when you keep it stored, it is not just air, but it has kerosene vapors along with air. Now this mixture of kerosene vapors and air is a potential disaster, because if there is a spark or any ignition or a particular temperature crossed, then it catches what is known as vapor cloud explosion. Now this vapor cloud explosion is an instantaneous fire in the entire kerosene vapor air mixture, and that gives you no time for controlling it at all. And then that begins and makes it a bad fire. How do we control fire? Normally, when you have to control any fire, the first thing you think of is water. But you have been told in school that if you put water on kerosene fire, it doesn't extinguish it. Why? Because water is heavier than kerosene, and water will sink in the kerosene and go to the bottom, and the kerosene at the top will merrily continue to burn. However, there is one way of doing this. But then if I extinguish fire of kerosene with water, how does it help kerosene burn? So today I'm going to tell you a story about how water can help kerosene burn when you want it to burn, and how it will help kerosene to not catch fire when you want it to be safe, both at the same time. It is possible to do that. For that, combination of water with kerosene can be done in many ways. For example, if I just suspend some droplets of water in kerosene, then what will happen is that the vapor in that tank will be not only kerosene, but it will be water vapor plus the kerosene along with air. And now technically, there is a word known as explosive limit. If I adjust the proportions of these three by adding water to a right extent, what happens is that this vapor mixture now is no longer capable of catching that explosive fire. And the liquid kerosene, in fact, you will be surprised that if I take an open bowl of kerosene and put a burning matchstick into that kerosene pool, it will actually extinguish rather than catching fire. It is not so easy to make that kerosene liquid burn. If it catches fire after a lot of efforts, then it will be a surface burning or pool burning, as it is called, very similar to a candle burning with wax on it. Then in that case, how is it that a stove allows that kerosene to burn? We studied that, and what we found is that in a primer stove, you have a stock of kerosene and then there is air above it, and then you hand crank some amount of air pressure into it. And with that pressure, kerosene comes up as a jet from a nozzle. And this kerosene then burns. However, those who have tried it at your home to start this primer stove will know that if I just start kerosene coming out and light a fire to it, it does not burn. I have to make sure that that entire nozzle is preheated to a fairly high temperature with something else, and only then I can start that kerosene to come into that nozzle, and then it will catch fire. When we saw this, we said, can we make use of this fact? And the fact that kerosene does not burn easily as a pool. For this, for a moment, let me take you to a technical aspect. And that takes me to materials which are known as surfactants. Surfactants are nothing but materials like soaps and detergents we use at home. Same property. But one of those surface active agents is also present in milk. And milk is actually a dispersion or an emulsion of oily material, the milk fat, in water. So surfactants can make an emulsion. So good idea, let me make emulsion of water inside kerosene so that instead of sinking, it may remain afloat. But the problem with this is I have to keep that milk maybe only for a few days. But the stored kerosene has to be kept for several weeks. And therefore, making emulsion alone does not solve the problem. But yes, if I make an emulsion of water in kerosene, it will take care of that accidental fire because of the vapor mixture. But it will not be enough for the second part which I want to be done. And for that, I take recourse to a special type of emulsion called as micro emulsion. These are emulsions with droplet size so small that any optical microscope cannot see it. Only electron microscopes can see it. But there are droplets. In fact, to the eye, it may look like a transparent solution. So in our group, which works in the area of surfactants for some time now, we made micro emulsion of water in kerosene. And then we looked at why does kerosene leave soot behind? When that nozzle gives out kerosene drops into that burning region of the primer stove, the kerosene first enters that burning zone, starts getting heated by the flame. It reaches almost a temperature of 200 degrees Celsius, and it is only then that the surface of that kerosene droplet catches fire. And now this droplet, which is moving through the flame to go away, it has only that much time, a fraction of a second, to burn completely Otherwise, if it is burning from the surface and not reached to the center, it means at the center, there will be an unburned portion of that tiny droplet left behind. And it is that tiny portion that leaves the flame and becomes soot. And the problem is, if this droplet is large, it is definitely not possible for the burning action to go right to the center and finish off all the kerosene there. So why not make tiny droplets of kerosene? Why make such large droplets? Remember, in a primer stove which is going to be used at a household, the pressure is applied by hand. So that means there is an upper limit to how much pressure I can apply for that flame or for that nozzle. And that pressure determines how fine a droplet can I create out of it. So typically, a millimeter or less kind of a droplet would be there, which comes out from that nozzle. And then it doesn't burn fully to the center, to the core of it, and then leaves soot. Now here comes the story about this microemulsions. Microemulsions are these very tiny water droplets, which are so small that they remain suspended by Brownian motion inside the kerosene. Now, when this kerosene droplet comes out through the nozzle, it is, let's say, a millimeter or even tenth of a millimeter kind of a droplet. This droplet, it reaches 200 degrees Celsius at its surface and then starts burning. But if there are tiny water droplets, sub-droplets, micro-droplets, actually nano-droplets inside this kerosene drop, then before the kerosene surface reaches 200 degrees Celsius, these droplets will cross 100 degrees Celsius. And what happens to liquid water when it reaches 100 degrees Celsius? It becomes vapor. And what is the volume required for 1 gram mole of a vapor compared to 1 gram mole of a liquid? 1 gram mole liquid is 18 milliliters water, and 1 gram mole of vapor is 22 something liters. So now, when this tiny nano droplet becomes vapor, it requires 1,000 times more volume. So what will happen to this kerosene drop when this liquid water vaporizes? This kerosene drop now ruptures into tiny fragments of kerosene drops, which means now the burning process can reach the center much easily before that droplet leaves the burning zone. When we got this idea, we actually tried it. And we took certain specific surfactants after a lot of trials, and we found that we can make a microemulsion of water in kerosene. And first thing we did was test it for that explosive fire experiment. We found that at least 20 degrees above the normal temperature at which kerosene vapors catch fire, this mixed kerosene does not catch that kind of fire. And when that kerosene droplet comes into that primer stove, there indeed it ruptured those droplets. We could not see it by any microscope because in that burning zone we could not do it. But when we collected soot which was coming out from the flame, a normal kerosene gave us about 500 milligrams of soot for a liter of kerosene. This formulated kerosene, 1 liter, gave us less than 5 milligrams of that soot. So over a 100-fold reduction in the soot which happened because of those microemulsion droplets. It not only prevented that explosive fire, but it helped the combustion of that kerosene completely, not leaving behind that soot particle. Now some people asked us, wouldn't that water mean it requires heat to boil that water? Indeed. But that extra soot particle which was otherwise not going to burn, it burns and provides that heat. So there is no reduction in the heat provided for the cooking purposes. Then somebody said, if you put it in a wick, because some of the stoves are wick stoves, then there is a small capillary through which kerosene rises upwards. The worry was, wouldn't these water droplets block that? But we tried that as well. And the capillary size is in several microns. And the microemulsion droplet size is 100-fold below that. So that water droplet easily rises through the wick with no blockage at all. And wick flame is very fine. The primer stove burns beautifully without giving any soot. And my stored kerosene can now is completely safe because it does not catch vapor cloud explosion and the liquid pool burning is a much safer activity. This is the result of our research which we did over a few years, presented in a short time. But if the idea of using science for direct applications is what you have got from it, I think I did my job. Thank you.